Gertrude Neuenhaus Mouka was educated at the University of Ghent in Belgium and trained in anesthesiology at University Hospital Ghent and University Medical Center Groningen in the Netherlands. She completed additional training in pain medicine and led a team of anesthesiologists in abdominal oncologic and transplant surgeries in Groningen. At the same time, she is working to complete her PhD on perioperative renal protective strategies in kidney transplantation. She is consultant anesthesiologist at the University Medical Center Groningen in the Netherlands. She has designed, led, and executed the VAPOR 1 trial, a single center RCT. She is now principal investigator and leader of two multi-center and international RCTs evaluating the effects of volatile versus intravenous anesthesia and remote ischemic conditioning in renal transplant outcomes. Dr. Neuenhaus Mouka's talk is titled Potential of Volatile Anesthetics in Organ Transplantation.
Thank you very much for the introduction and also for the invitation to tell you a little bit more about the potential of VOTA anesthetics in organ transplantation. First, a few disclosures. Traditionally, surgical care has focused on the operation and the disease being treated with this operation. However, in 2012, Crockett and Pierce, they postulated a very interesting shift in paradigm in the BGA, in which they stated that the response to surgery must be considered a primary disease process and the consequent organ failure the condition to focus on. And they are supported in this by a very large cohort analysis of Curie, and they analyzed over 100,000 patients undergoing 1 out of 8 major surgery procedures, and they found out that the most important determinant of long-term survival was the occurrence of 1 out of 22 predefined post-operative complications. And those complications ranged from superficial wound infection to acute kidney injury or myocardial infarction. And the development of post-operative complications are most likely due to a complex interplay between the underlying disease of the patient, the physiological reserve and comorbidity of the patient, and the immune response to surgery and anesthesia. And increasing evidence is gained that intraoperative interventions, such as maintenance of normothermia, intraoperative fluid management optimization, or the choice of anesthetic agent, reduce incidence of postoperative complications. Hence, the consequences of the choices we have to make each day in operating theater expand beyond the doors of our operating theater. And in that OR, we have to make many choices. For instance, what kind of anesthetic agent are we going to give this patient undergoing this kind of surgery? Are we going to use propofol, or are we going to use a VOTA anesthetic agent? And now you may think, well, does it really matter? As long as my patient's happily asleep and the surgeon's happy, I'm happy. But is that the case? We know that the drugs we use do not only provide general anesthesia, but they affect many cells and systems in our body. And interest in this pleiotropic effect of anesthetics is not something new. Already in 1911, Gaylord and Simpson found out that when breast cancer cells of mice were exposed to ether, they grew more rapidly. And a few years later, Graham saw that when leukocytes were exposed to ether, they weren't as good in phagocytizing bacteria. And after these early discoveries, it was silent for quite a while. But the past few decades, there's an increased interest in the choice of anesthetics and outcome of the patient. And then you can think of the effect of our drugs on the brain or the immune system, but also on certain phenomena that can occur during anesthesia, like ischemia and reperfusion injury. And the last one I want to tell you a little bit more about. What is ischemia and reperfusion injury? When cells become ischemic, they switch to anaerobic glycolysis, which will leave them with with ATP depletion. Due to this ATP depletion, several electron pumps will start to fail, and the several electrolytes will accumulate intracellularly, like sodium, calcium, which will result in a cellular edema. Various enzymes will be activated, and various proteases will be formed. due to the acidosis, there will be lysosomal instability and leakage of lysosomal enzymes into the intracellular space. This will harm the cells, the cytoskeleton, the membranes, the mitochondria, and the DNA, and eventually can lead to apoptosis or, in worst case scenario, necrosis. So, ischemia, cell damage, and cell death. And when you compare ischemia with a small forest fire, you can imagine what happens when you turn on the oxygen. Your small forest fire will now become a massive conflagration. Although ATP formation is restored and there's reoxygenation, you get a massive amount of ROS being formed. And due to the pH normalization, the intracellular calcium load will further increase. Those two together will lead to opening of the mitochondrial permeability transition pores, and furthermore, the pH normalization will cause activation of the proteases who are being formed during the ischemia. So, reperfusion is more cell damage and more cell death. And the most harm is during this reperfusion phase. This gives rise to a very complex pathophysiological phenomenon called ischemia and reperfusion injury. And as I was said, as a consequence of ischemia and reperfusion, cell death programs are activated, like apoptosis, necrosis, and necroptosis. And at the vascular level, endothelial cells will start to swell, the glycocalyx will be lost, and the actin skeleton will be broken down. As a consequence, intracellular contacts are lost with an increased vascular permeability and fluid loss to the interstitial space. Several vasoactive substances are produced, causing vasoconstriction, or in worst case scenario, total no reflow phenomenon, in which microcirculation completely fails. And due to the fact that the glycocalyx is lost, several adhesion molecules are now exposed, facilitating the transmigration of leukocytes to the interstitium. The innate and adaptive immune system will be activated, and luckily, our cells also have their own protective mechanism against ischemia and reperfusion injury, which is called transcriptional reprogramming. And I will tell you a little bit more about that later on. So back to our pleiotropic effects. We know that some of the drugs we use are able to induce biochemical changes that may attenuate IRI. And this phenomenon is called anesthetic conditioning, and is referred to as pre, per, or post conditioning, depending on the timing of introduction of the agent. Anesthetic conditioning is mostly described for volatile anesthetic agents, and to a much lesser extent for propofol. And most likely, the trifluorohalogenated carbon groups, which are part of all modern volatiles, are responsible for this effect. The mechanism behind it is very complex, and multiple pathways are involved. And if you gather all the research that has been done since the mid-80s about volatile anesthetic agents and anesthetic conditioning, you will see that the volatile anesthetics will interfere with many of the processes underlying the pathophysiology of IRI. First of all, they are able to intervene with activation of the cell death programs. And this is probably a very busy slide, but what you see is when you introduce volatile anesthetics in the early phase of reperfusion, they are able to prevent opening of the mitochondrial permeability transition pores, most likely because they reduce the activity at complex tree of the mitochondrial respiratory chain. This will lead to the formation of small amounts of superoxide, which then react with nitric oxide and form peroxynitrite. Peroxynitrite then inhibits the activity at complex 1, leading to further formation of superoxide. Superoxide will act as a second messenger and facilitates the phosphorylation of PKC epsilon. And PKC epsilon phosphorylated is able to open the potassium channels in the mitochondrial membrane. This leads to an influx of potassium into the mitochondria and a reduction of the membrane potential of the mitochondrial inner membrane. These reductions are associated with a reduced production of the mitochondrial transition pores. Second, superoxide is able to activate the RISC pathway. And the RISC pathway is also involved in ischemic conditioning. The RISC pathway, upon activation, glycolysis synthase kinase 3 beta is inhibited and nitric oxide is formed. And both of them are able to inhibit opening of these pores or even closing of the pores. So then on an endothelial level, photoanesthetics are able to protect the glycocalyx. This is shown in vitro and in vivo in animal experiments, and pre as well as post conditioning are effective in this. In an isolated guinea pig heart model that's subjected to 20 minutes of ischemia followed by reperfusion, pre- or post-conditioning with 15 minutes of sevoflurane resulted in a reduced level of extravasation of fluid and reduced levels of syndican 1, heparan sulfate, and hyaluron. Syndican 1 is one of the most important proteoglycanes of the glycocalyx. And in a similar model, these authors infused leukocytes and platelets, and what they saw was that in the treated hearts, there was a near-to-baseline adhesion of these cells compared to the non-treated groups. And when you look at the glycocalyx with the electron microscopy, you see that in the treated groups, the glycocalyx is preserved. The authors suggest that as a proposed mechanism, sevoflurane was able to stabilize the lysosomal membrane, which resulted in a lower release of cathepsin B, a lysosomal protease that is inflicted in breakdown of the extracellular matrix. Then modulation of the immune response and well, upon ischemia and reperfusion injury, there are a lot of dams that are released, and those dams are able to activate the innate immune system either by activation of the complement system or by binding to toll-like receptors. Sorry. Something happened over here. Yeah, I'll wait for you. Yeah, sorry. Thank you. By binding to the toll-like receptors, this will cause inflammation, and you get an influx of all kinds of cells from the innate immune system, like natural killer cells, neutrophils, macrophages, and consequently, the adaptive immune system is activated. The last couple of years, there's an increasing interest in the influence of anesthetic agents on the immune system, and not only in the field of ischemia reperfusion injury, but also when it comes to oncological surgery. And when we look at all the work that has been done, and it's mostly in vitro or animal experiments, we see that volatile anesthetic agents have an influence on many cells of the innate immune system. And, well, I'm not going to read them all to you. You can see them over here. But the net effect is that they are inducing an immunosuppressive effect. And if you look at the cells of the adaptive immune system, you see the same. So you get a lower number and proliferation of T cells. You get a decrease in your Th1-Th2 ratio, what is extremely important and beneficial in organ transplantation. And B cells also lower number and induction of B cell injury. Additionally, what's also very interesting is the work of Yuki and his colleagues, and they saw that volatile anesthetics were able to inhibit the activation of a lymphocyte function-associated antigen 1, LFA1. And LFA1 is an integrin molecule of the family of adhesion molecules, which is expressed on all leukocytes. And LFA1 is activated by chemokines or antigens, which then induce conformational changes to the molecule. This is in the closed inactivated state, and this is the activated state. And the activated state allows binding of LFA1 with its major ligand, and the major ligand of LFA1 is ICAM1, intracellular adhesion molecule 1. The expression of ICAM1 increases upon injury. And then LFA1, ICAM1 endothelial interaction will facilitate leukocyte migration. When it comes to natural killer cells, ICAM1, LFA1 will cause activation of the natural killer cells and lysis of the target cells. And when it comes to T cells, it facilitates binding and activation of the T cells. The Levodopa inhibit LFA1 at the lovastatin binding site, so it keeps it in an inactive state. And it does that in vitro at clinically relevant concentrations, so at 1 mg. It's also described for propofol, but then on supernormal concentrations. And recently, blockade of LFA1 is recognized as a potential target to reduce allograft rejection and then in pancreatic islet transplantation. Okay, and then finally, transcriptional reprogramming. As I said earlier, our cells have their own protection against hypoxia. And this is by the means of hypoxic inducible factors. HIFs are transcription factors that are involved in the metabolic cell cycle gene regulation, and they provide a protection against hypoxia. It are heterodimeric proteins that consist of a alpha and a beta chain. Under normal circumstances, HIF alpha is hydroxylized by oxygen-sensing prolyl hydroxylases, and that causes conformational changes to the alpha subunit, which allows von Hippel-Lindau protein suppressor tumor suppressor protein to bind, which leads to the degradation of the alpha subunit. However, under anaerobic circumstances, this doesn't happen. So HIF alpha then goes to the nucleus and binds with HIF beta subunit, and they bind on the hypoxic response promoter element, which will cause to the transcription of various genes like glycolysis enzymes, VGF, EPO, FOXP3, etc. The upregulation of HIF by Votar anesthetic is most recently been described as one of the underlying processes in anesthetic conditioning. And Votar anesthetics are able to upregulate HIF-1 alpha and HIF-2 alpha. In an isolated heart model, 15 minutes of post-conditioning with sevoflurane led to the upregulation of HIF-1 alpha and improved mitochondrial and myocardial function. The results in this study were abolished with 2-methoxyestradiol, an HIF inhibitor. And in a renal IR model in a rat, preconditioning with sevoflurane led to lower creatinine levels and higher HIF-2 alpha expression. The effects were abolished in a HIF-2 alpha knockout mice. On the other hand, propofol inhibits HIF-1 alpha production. So, in conclusion, Votar anesthetics interfere with many of the processes underlying the pathophysiology of IRI, and they have a potentially protective effect against IRI. Although these effects are dose and timing and context dependent, and clinical studies are needed to look whether this is clinically relevant. So we're back in the OR, and our next patient is a kidney transplant recipient. What we know is that IRI is inevitable in organ transplantation. Clinically, IRI will manifest as delayed graft function, a form of acute kidney injury post-transplantation, or in worst-case scenario, primary non-function, in which the graft never gains function. DGF, delayed graft function, is a risk factor for acute rejection and is associated with graft loss. DGF is also a clinically relevant problem. It is accompanied by increased morbidity, patient anxiety, and a prolonged hospitalization, and is accompanied by additional diagnostic procedures and costs. So back to our patients and all what we do, what we know at the moment, the use of a volatile anesthetic agent in these patients would seem the most logical choice. And if we see, if we look at the work that has been done already in this area, and it's mostly the group of Thomas Lee, who did from Columbia University, who did an enormous amount of work in this area, they showed that rats anesthetized with a volatile anesthetic agent and subjected to renal IRI showed reduced levels of plasma creatinine and pro-inflammatory cytokines, and reduced histological renal necrosis 72 hours after the renal IRI, compared to rats anesthetized with pentobarbital aketamine. In mice anesthetized with isoflurane and subjected to renal IRI, this has led to a reduction of neutrophil, macrophages, and lymphocyte infiltration 3 hours post the reperfusion. However, in humans, there were no clinical data. So therefore, we have designed the VAPOR trial. And VAPOR is short for Volatile Anesthetic Protection of Renal Transplants. It's a two-step study, and we look at the difference in renal protective effect of two representative models, methods in anesthesia in kidney transplantation. We compare Ativa, so propofol remifentanil-based anesthesia, versus Aceivaforane remifentanil-based anesthesia. In 2010, we started with the VAPOR 1 study. This was a prospective single-blind, single-center RCT. And we started in living donor kidney transplantation. We did this because this setting provided us with the optimal research setting. It has a homogeneous model of IRI, reproducible ischemia times, and we had the possibility to treat the donor. However, the amount of injury in this setting is extremely low, so we considered it a proof of concept. And we hypothesized that a sevoflurane-based anesthesia was able to induce anesthetic conditioning and thereby reduces post-transplant renal injury, reflected by a reduced release of kidney injury biomarkers compared to a propofol anesthesia. Donor and recipients were coupled and randomized to one of the three groups, so prop, where both received propofol, sevo, where both received sevo, and prose, where the donor received propofol and the recipient received sevoflurane. As a primary outcome, we've chosen a set of three kidney injury biomarkers that reflected the complete kidney. And as a secondary outcome measures, we looked at the biopsy, serum analysis, measured GFR, DGF, PNF, graft loss, and postoperative complications, length of hospital stay, and acute rejection. The follow-ups of this study was 2 years. So first of all, the primary outcome. We measured the levels of KIM-1, NACH, and heart fatty acid binding protein in the first urine produced upon reperfusion, so that's time point zero, then 2 hours after reperfusion, day one, day two, day six, and day nine. In the first urine produced upon reperfusion, there was no difference between the groups for one of the biomarkers. After that, the levels of HFAB declined and showed the pattern we expected of a biomarker. Kim, on the other hand, and NACH showed unexpected patterns, and after a decline, it started to rise again. This was the fact for Kim as well as for NACH. And on day two, levels of Kim and NACH were higher, significantly higher in the SIVO group compared to the propofol group, and this was almost the fact for the PROSE group. We believe that this secondary rise is not due to injury, but a reflection of regeneration of the tubular system. When we look at the secondary outcome measures, there were no differences between the groups, with the exception of one thing. What we saw, most surprisingly, was that the sevoflurane groups had a significantly lower acute rejection rate over a follow-up period of 2 years. And we know this, the groups are very small and the study is not powered on this, but it was surprising. And we looked at the rejections and they were all T-cell mediated. There were no antibody mediated rejections and donor specific antigens were negative. And if we looked at the risk factors for rejection, like HLA mismatches or PRA levels, they were highest in the SIVO group. So it was a surprise. So in conclusion, SIVO showed higher urinary KIM-1 and NACHT levels in living donor kidney transplantation second day after transplantation. This was, however, not reflected in inferior graft outcome. On the contrary, we did a correlation, and what we saw was that levels of a higher level of KIM and NACHT first and second day are correlated to a better graft outcome a month after the transplantation. Furthermore, lower acute rejection rate was seen in the SIVO groups. And what we know is that acute rejection is a multi-head model. It's not a one-step thing. And an inflammatory environment due to pharyngeal injury during the transplantation makes the graft more prone to acute and also chronic rejection. So we can ask whether anesthesia is one of the keys to lock the door to rejection. The next step we're now working on is VAPOR 2. And VAPOR 2 is an international multicenter RCT, which is conducted in four countries in Europe: Norway, Oslo, Denmark, Aarhus, Barcelona, Spain, and of course in our own center. And we look now at the recipients of DBD and DCD donors, where the amount of injury is much greater, much more pronounced than in living donor kidney transplantation. We have two groups, and we started with the inclusion May last year. The primary outcome of this study is now a clinical parameter, DGF, and we have to include 488 patients. Furthermore, we're going to look at graft and patient survival, of course, primary non-function rejection, and we hope to look into the mechanisms of protection and immune modulation. And finally, in the end, we hope we can answer the question whether anesthetics can attribute to a better outcome after kidney transplantation. Thank you.